specialization in molecular thermodynamics from the University of Florida. Yesterday we had a reference to the University of Florida where Gatorade drink was invented. You were there at that?
Just after I left.
Just after.
I'm claiming me.
Yeah, okay. Now, we can go through all the courses he has taught and so on. But I think two of his initiatives have really transformed. Academic education in this country. One is NPTEL. So it's had a far-reaching impact, not just in the country, but among friends and foes alike. Abroad, Pakistan is using NPTEL more than our own students. The other one is Research Park. Now, at least every IIT is being asked to reproduce the IIT Madras. So, others will also be asked to do it in due course of time. Presently, Ananth is chairman BOG of IIIT.
Too early to say that. Okay. Very good morning to all of you. Yes, Dr. Murli there disappeared. I wanted to thank him for introducing me. He's there. Okay. Yeah, thank you. I was telling Murli that I don't know how one talks about leadership. So what I'll do is describe some of the things that I did in IIT Madras, plus the first part particularly. I've divided my talk into four parts. The first part is about a traditional university. It's things everybody knows, but you know, because of our preoccupation with our routine, we sort of forget to think about it. We are so occupied with doing things that we always do every day that we don't pause to reflect on what the university is about. So I'd like to recall some thoughts on that. And then the second part is about somebody's.
We request you to keep your mobiles in silent mode, please. Yeah, please. But the bus. You turn it off here.
Okay. So the second part is about new demands on the university. That's what Arthu Murli mentioned. I was thinking of it when I started this NPTEL and the research part. The third part is about governance. I'll share some thoughts on governance. These are to a large extent, you might say, common sense plus knowledge of the background. I think it's a combination of the two. And the last one is on ethics, which is something that we find very difficult to talk to students about, but I think it's important that we do. And the point being that I keep telling my colleagues, especially, I think 55 and older are also guilty. we tend not to give, not to tell students any ethical principles, pretending that we are so liberal that it's either obvious or we don't notice their when they transgress the principles. But I think when we tell them something and they call you a bore, it doesn't matter. You may actually be a bore, but that doesn't matter. The important thing is the message. If you have communicated the message, that's more important than the messenger being a bore. So I want to share some thoughts on that. It's not easy to communicate, but there are some ways in which I think we have successfully communicated this. So I'll go on, start off. As I said, this is in four parts. I'll talk about the traditional university to begin with, which has essentially teaching and research as the components. And then the demands of the knowledge economy are increasing the gross enrollment ratio, which is the ratio of people enrolled in higher education divided by the number eligible to be enrolled. And this was a miserable 18% when I took over as director, it was about 18%. And then it's increased considerably now to 32 or 33%, but it's still lower than that of most developed countries. And the importance of GER is that it appears.
It's a slight disconnect.
Okay, is this better now? Can you tell?
It's the same.
It's the same?
Yeah, but this is at the maximum.
Yeah. So the importance of GER, there is a UN study that shows that that the gross enrollment ratio should be at least 30% before any country can take advantage of the global economy. So you need a higher GER, and we are now supposedly at 32. It's still not satisfactory. That's what made me think of NPTEL at that time. The second is contributing to the economy through IPRs. There's some data that has been always on the net, but somehow we don't always read it. But turns out 40% of the income of developed countries, say UK, USA, Germany, all these comes from IPR. And we did an analysis of Silicon Valley IPRs, about 100 of them. Turned out about 50% of them, 70% had IITian names, Indian names in it, and 50% of them had IITian names in it. That means somehow we were contributing to the development of the IPR, but the IPR actually went only to US or UK or Germany. So that was why the research park idea came. Then there are always issues of governance, and there's a nice book by Charles West, who was MIT, president of MIT, passed away about 5-6 years ago. He wrote a book on research universities, and he has a large number of ideas about governance that I think are very useful. It's not that we don't know these, but these are articulated well. Then the last one is ethics in the university, so that will be the thing. I'll start off on the first part. About the traditional university, I have essentially 5 points to make, or 5 slides on this. Since the Renaissance thinkers, what they thought about it, because that's what our university is based on. I'll talk about the pursuit of learning. This is essentially a nice article on the idea of a university by Oakeshott, who was a political scientist in Oxford, and a little bit by Chomsky. They are only saying things others have said, but they have said it very strongly and rather nicely. I want to share some principles of teaching with you, partly borrowed from Aurobindo, but you always pick things that you agree with others on and talk about those. And then I'll say a few words about research. But the reason I want to talk about principles of teaching and research is because that sets the atmosphere for what you are governing. You are governing a university. And these are the most important aspects even now of the university, and that's why I want to talk about them a bit. First is that the traditional university basically is built on the ideas of Renaissance thinkers. We also had universities back in the in India, but they didn't formulate the ideas behind the university as clearly. We had the Renaissance thinkers first assumed, one, that the material world is lawful, means the non-living world obeys laws. Then secondly, that there is an intrinsic unity of knowledge that underlies all the material world's behavior. In fact, they said you can only discover it by a combination of natural and social sciences. The importance of social sciences was emphasized at that time. In India, because of various compulsions, we started the institutes of technology, which are not actually universities. We have a very weak humanities component. But the Renaissance thinkers were convinced that you cannot discover the unity without the help of natural and social sciences. Natural sciences includes engineering and medicine. Social sciences includes humanities. And then there is the assumption, this is a hypothesis, that education can lead to indefinite progress of human beings. Sort of on an average, this is borne out. Then in the 19th century, von Humboldt said research brings passion to teaching, while teaching rejuvenates the researcher, which means the two have to go hand in hand. You can't separate them. In fact, the important thing that Humboldt introduced, I don't think the Germans quite follow it as well as they should, is that the researcher and the teacher should be one and the same, practically. The Oakeshott has a nice essay on the idea of university. The idea of university, the famous essay is, I think, by Cardinal Newman, but Newman is hard to read. I don't know if you have read Newman. Everything he says is all right, but every sentence you have to read twice and then make it shorter, remove some words, and then make sense to us these days. It's rather like reading Dickens. But Oakeshott has a nice essay, and this he points out that the pursuit of learning occurs everywhere in society. It also occurs in the university. But the pursuit of learning in the university is characterized by two important features. One is no immediate use. This is something that many, many politicians would disagree with. But the idea is that, first of all, I mean, this was stated even by Buddha long ago, that ignorance of why you were born and insecurity are the two characteristics of all human beings. And so in a sense, ignorance is something that all of us share. And we don't really know what is good in the long run, what is not good, and so on. So what the university does is simply ask, in its search for unity, is there a difficulty, conceptual difficulty at any point? If there is a conceptual difficulty, it's a valid problem to do research on in the university. When the industry tells you what use is that, you tell them you don't know either. You simply pretend to know what's useful and what's not. Because if you have an industry and you're making radiator caps, you can always say what should be done with radiator caps. I mean, so small a problem that you know immediately what's the next useful thing. But you're talking about life, you're talking about training students who go into a variety of jobs. You have no idea at all. So the only question you can ask is there a conceptual difficulty in understanding this problem? If there is, it's a valid problem for you to do research on. Attention to detail, of course, is very, very important. Because you don't build without such attention to detail. He says, I've taken this from Oakeshott's essay. He says, it's not for the power that it may bring. It is not for learning the tricks of a trade. I'm talking about higher education. I'm not talking about vocational training. So it's not for preparing for a future profession or even for a service to society. It's not for acquisition of an outfit to see one through life. It's not for any of these things. The curriculum has no such design and teaching no such intention. These things are all very important in life, but they are not the purpose of higher education. So admirable in themselves, these things belong to a world of power and utility and exploitation. So he says a world that is not self-critical. And this is not a criticism of the world outside, because all that I say can also apply to academicians. There are lots of people within the university also who are not self-critical as they ought to be. And so it's also these characteristics belong to a world that is apt to mistake itself for the whole world, which is what happens often with the industry. They come back and complain saying, your students don't know even this, they don't know even that. Sometimes our alumni come and tell us this. And since I'm old enough, I ask the alumni, you forget exactly what you knew when you graduated. And then they say, you can't turn it around on me. And then I say, I will. Because what your business is to find out what my student knows, what not what my student doesn't know. So I think in the placement office, we ought to tell the people when they come, they only should ask if there is a conceptual understanding in the student. Then he picks up what they want for the industry in the next 6 months of training. So he says, Yogshat says correctly that the industry, for example, assumes that whatever does not contribute to its own purposes is somehow errant. And he adds saying, in the face of an ulterior purpose of this sort, education steals out of the back door with noiseless steps. I think we have to be careful. We have a territory to defend that's harder to defend because the economic consequences are not obvious. In fact, I had a student about when I was still director in IIT Madras. He had passed just 10 years earlier. He was already vice president in Reliance. So he came and told me, sir, how can you sit in that seat after this many years of experience earning less than what I get for PR allowance per month? He was getting some 2 lakhs just published allowance for treating people and smiling at them and so on. But this is true, the monetary benefits that in education are much lower, although now there are many opportunities under consultancy. But I think that's not the purpose of education. Chomsky has a very nice, Chomsky says a lot, so I don't know exactly where I took this from, but you can read about Chomsky and education everywhere. He gets into conflict with just about everybody. But he is a remarkable thinker. He says the university's traditional ideal is to foster creative and independent thought and inquiry, challenge perceived beliefs, explore new horizons, and forget external constraints. Now, this idea of forgetting external constraints I didn't quite understand it when I first read it, but it came to me long back when I joined IIT Madras as a faculty member. Very first consultancy assignment that I got, this fellow called me and said, I have a lot of hot gases going out of my reverberatory furnace. Can I recover this with a heat exchanger? I said, fine. Heat exchangers are easy to design. This is gas to thermal fluid. And when I started designing it, he called me next day and said, please make sure you use 2-inch tubes. I said, why 2-inch tubes? He says, my neighbor is throwing it away free. The neighboring factory was closing down and he was giving it away. So I said, you can't be cheaper than that. So you have to use 2-inch tubes. And then 2 days later, he called me and said, don't make it longer than 4 feet. Because then I have to raise the ceiling, and raising the ceiling will cost me 3 lakhs. These are external constraints. But how do you go to a heat transfer class and tell students, don't make a heat exchanger longer than 4 feet? You don't do all this. These are things you have to take care of on the spot, but it's not part of education as such. So when you teach students, and when an industrialist tells you your students are impractical, I merely tell them, I hope they continue to be so. I think they can learn to be practical in the industry once they taste money. In fact, Chomsky himself says, this is indeed flawed in practice, but the extent to which it is realized is a measure of the level of civilization achieved. I think this is an important point. The point is that we always design systems to be ideal. They're never ideal. But you don't have to insist that every part of it has to be ideal. Even a 20-30% realization of the ideal is itself a significant achievement. You shouldn't compromise on the ideals because the practice is non-ideal. You can take the practice into account to some extent and be tolerant, but you cannot compromise on the ideals themselves. The human and social costs of abandoning the traditional ideal are immeasurable. You know, when one of the ministers, when I was director in the council, you know, when we had this IIT council meeting and we had a coffee break, and he said, you know, I'm spending 10 lakh crores on higher education in India. How do I justify that? I don't remember the exact figure. My recollection is it's 10 lakh crores. I told him simply that in all these things, the figures are so large that I don't have an idea of whether you should spend this much or not. But I'll tell you how to decide the problem. You ask what is the cost of not doing it. And not giving higher education, essentially not paying attention to higher education, between say the 13th and the 18th centuries in India, cost us this whole thing. The colonization occurred because of that. We were not even up with the science, we were not up with anything. When the guns came, we hadn't even studied Newton's laws to be able to understand how they worked and so on. And so the colonization, according to, I think, one of the recent talks by Shashi Tharoor, said it cost us $11,000 billion or something, an extraordinary figure, which is two more zeros than what they were spending on higher education. So I said, this is the cost, so you may as well spend this much on higher education. But I think in all these cases, that's how one makes a decision. Even at a lower level, as director of an institution, you should ask what is the cost of not doing it. And you have to calculate the long-term cost in some ways. And if the cost of not doing something is more than the cost of doing it, then you may as well do it. You have to find the funds to do it. So let me say a few words. There are two important characteristics here, of the traditional university: teaching and research. The first principle of teaching, according to Aurobindo, is nothing can be taught. That means all of us lose our jobs. But what Aurobindo really says is that teacher is a facilitator of learning. It's not as if you teach a student how to fill a bucket. You rather teach a student how to open the tap. You sort of teach the student how to think. If you open the tap in Chennai, for instance, you don't get water very often, but that's a different situation. But I think the nice thing about this is, to say this in Kanpur is nice. The first director of IIT Kanpur was Professor Kelkar. I never met him, but I've been an admirer from a distance. And one of my friends joined Kanpur when I joined IIT Madras way back in 1972. And he taught fluid mechanics. And like all young faculty members, the first time you teach a course, you get so enthusiastic, you want to teach everything you know. So you pack too much into it, and the course was a bit of a mess. The teacher was not satisfied, nor were the students. And my friend went straight to Professor Kelkar. Professor Kelkar apparently was a very approachable director. So he went to him and said, "Professor Kelkar, I cannot cover the portions in this course." Then Professor Kelkar gave him a cup of coffee, made him sit down, patted him on the back, and said, "Young man, I did not hire you to cover any portions. I actually hired you to uncover a part of them." I thought that was a beautiful statement. It was absolutely, it's really illuminating, because it's not as if the student survives because of you. You know, you do your job, and if you can share your joys, some pleasures that you got when reading the subject with the student, then the guy thinks, maybe I can extract pleasure out of this too. So I think that's the important point. Unfortunately for Professor Kelkar, the only people who listen to him, as far as I can see, are the fashion industry people. It's about covering the portions and uncovering a part. The second point that Aurobindo makes, this is a nice book on education by Aurobindo. Again, Aurobindo's English is rather difficult, but you find that when you look at the dictionary, the word he uses is very appropriate. But it's very unusual. But in any case, he says you should give examples from the student's own environment. And this is something that's hard for us to do in India, mainly because we have an oral tradition. We don't document our experiences. For example, one of my colleagues teaches air pollution. And the only example he has is Los Angeles. You sit in Chennai and you give examples from Los Angeles, because data is available extensively for Los Angeles. We are beginning to have data, and I had also a peculiar experience. I was teaching, I don't know if this happens in Kanpur, when I first joined Chennai, one of the courses that nobody wanted to teach was chemical technology. So they dump it on the youngest faculty member.
It is everywhere.
Yeah. So I started teaching, and I thought I should give data from Madras refineries in those days. This is now called Chennai Petroleum. So I thought I'd get some data. And the industrial data has a lot of scatter in it, because the data is not measured so accurately. So I asked, turned out we had many students there, and I asked them to get me some data, and they got me data over 5 years. It turned out 5 years, every September 5th, every sunny day, in September, the data was the same as what was their previous year. Because our fellows had learned to copy from the lab, in the, you know, the reports in the lab, and they had done the same thing in the industry as well, except that they were clever. If it was a rainy day, they chose a rainy day and copied the data and so on. Because nobody took the data seriously. It's not as if these kids were cheating. They were good, sincere workers, but they didn't fill up the forms right. And with the result, I found that the data was, there was too much error in the data for you to come to any conclusions. So we need to ask our students when they go out to please take their job seriously and feedback their experience so that you can use it in the class. The third point that Aurobindo makes is diverse approaches to the same problem can be more educative than doing a diverse set of problems. I think this is an important point, and also to use, let me give you a story. This is actually told by Grothendieck, a great mathematician, and he said a physicist and a mathematician were both called, given a glass of water and asked to make tea. So they boiled the water, added tea leaves, etc., made tea. Then they were both called again and given two empty glasses and asked to make tea. The physicist filled it with water, boiled the water again, made tea. The mathematician filled it with water, left it on the table. He said, by the previous theorem, I've already made tea. So I think the idea of reducing a problem to a known problem is not so often used in our education system. And using that gives you an idea of the unity underlying the knowledge much more than doing diverse problems. This is of course not very good idea for preparing for an entrance exam, because in entrance exam the speed is important, and if you have seen the problem before, you do it faster. But as far as education is concerned, I think this is a very important point. I don't know if everybody does that. I have actually done it in some cases where the student said, he went so far as to say in the final exam, he wrote saying, this is the same problem as problem 2 in quiz 1 that you gave us, therefore, and I gave him full marks. And his classmates objected. He said he saved a lot of time by doing this. But I said he recognized the point. And in fact, that kid is now in faculty member in IIT Madras, doing very well. He's a professor. But anyway, repetition is a necessary part of teaching. This is something that came home to me quite strikingly. When I first went to the US, one of the professors wanted to drag me off to listen to your pastor. And he said, this man speaks very well, you should come and listen. So I went. It was Sunday morning, early morning, very reluctant, but I went there, and this pastor spoke very well, but he repeated himself 7 times. So in those days I was a good listener as well, so I heard all the 7 versions. And I went to him at the end of the talk and said, how come you repeated yourself 7 times? He said, gee, did I do that? Then I did, right? Because in the school of pastors, they tell me, only 1/7 of the congregation is listening at any time. So most of us repeat ourselves. I think it's important because the class is not listening all the time. We've been students too. So we sort of tell them what we are going to tell them, then we tell them, then we tell them what we told them. So that we provide some continuity if they missed. And I think it's important because the message doesn't go always get across. Now, practice leads to perfection. This is something that's more important, I think, for the industry than for us. Although for us also, it's, to some extent, it's important. But I think this is nicely illustrated by one of my profs used to tell us a story about a big game hunter in Africa who went out to shoot lions, wildlife. And then he came back. He had one bullet left, and he came back tired in the evening back to camp. Just before he was going to enter the camp, what did he see? He saw a lion ready to pounce on him. And then he took aim and shot and missed. The lion pounced and missed him, and he ran into the camp, escaped. So next morning at 4 o'clock, he got up. He was really disgusted with himself. He came out to practice shooting at short range. And what did he find? He found the lion practicing short jumps. I mean, this is a continuous process. But I think it's important that you practice all the time, so that especially for classes, I don't know if my son studied with one professor, Pierre Rameau, who is a well-known high energy physics man, who was a postdoc in Caltech when Feynman was a teacher. And Rameau told him the story. that when Feynman, I don't know if you've seen Feynman's lectures, you must have all seen Feynman's lectures. One of the first lectures in physics, he starts out, he has a microphone wire and he walks along, trips on the wire, well, just doesn't fall, he balances and talks about unstable equilibrium. It's done beautifully. Then Pierre Ramon told my son, he practiced it 35 times and fell 30 times before he actually gave the lecture. He was practicing the previous night before he gave the lecture next morning, and everybody thought it was spontaneous. They said, how remarkable Feynman is. He tripped and he didn't fall, and then he gave this lecture. But I think the important thing is, for the students, it was a very impressive thing. And your practicing well before the class certainly helps to deliver a really impressive finished product. Next question is, what limits what we teach? What do we teach undergraduates? What do we teach postgraduates? When I first started teaching thermodynamics, my senior colleague told me, I saw the board, you're teaching some advanced topics, you shouldn't do this. I said, why? Because you won't have anything to teach them afterwards. I mean, he was a very nice colleague. He was a good teacher himself. And there was not anything really wrong, but philosophically it sounded all wrong. If the student can absorb it, you should teach it. Actually, I've come to that conclusion. What I've decided is that what I understand very well, I teach undergraduates. What I understand so-so, I'll teach postgraduates. And what I don't understand at all, I'll teach PhD students, because there you're sharing your ignorance. But there is something to be said about how you assign topics to undergraduates and to postgraduates. Okay, let me say a little bit about research. The question is, what drives research? There's either fundamental understanding or considerations of use. And if fundamental understanding is what really drives completely, you get to this quadrant up there, which is called the Bohr quadrant. And this is pure basic research, and this is really what the university does best. Then there is pure applied research, which is called the Edison quadrant. There it's considerations of use. So there is the industry quadrant, and the use-inspired basic research quadrant is called the Pasteur quadrant, because Pasteur, from his practice, he asked questions that were important in medicine that had to be studied in a fundamental way. And anyway, the quadrant to be avoided is this: if you are the director of an institution, you can ask the question, if it's neither useful nor has any basic improvement in basic understanding, you should request that colleague stop working on that. I think that's harder to do, eliminating that quadrant. But the other three are the important quadrants. And the Pasteur quadrant is really where research parks lie. I'll talk about that a little later. I want to say a few words about what we know about understanding, creativity and the brain. Sperry got his Nobel Prize in neuroscience in 1981, I think. He and his co-workers, one of them is called Gazzaniga, he's written a beautiful book on the brain. So they did a lot of split brain experiments. They worked with people who had accidents and one part of their brain was damaged. And while they were very good surgeons and physicians, they also studied the effect of this. And they came to the conclusion that this is well known. I think there's lots of refinements of this. This is oversimplifying the picture. But the left brain is basically logical and the right brain is intuitive. And it's freedom from logic that makes the right brain so effective in generating ideas. So you can get all kinds of ideas from the right brain. But most of the ideas, when tested, fail logically. And therefore, you have to go back and generate more ideas. So the left brain is equally important in the process. And what Sperry and co-workers point out is that it's the synergy between the two parts that is the real basis of creativity. So research is basically a creative activity. And it's a search for truth and all that. Unlike coursework, research relies considerably on intuition, which is really why you want fresh brains. You know, when you can't solve a problem, you get your good PhD student and you hope he has an idea that will trigger off the solution. But I think the important thing is that there's some things that I want to say. One is, first, the right brain can only survive in an atmosphere of trust. Because it's not logical, it can't explain itself. You can't ask me, how do you do this? I think there's a famous thing about a snail that walked up to a centipede walking along, and stopped the centipede and said, you have 100 legs, which of these 100 legs do you put forward first before walking? And they say the centipede stopped walking afterwards, still thinking which one. So what you can do intuitively doesn't necessarily mean you logically understand the whole thing. In fact, there was a very amusing episode that I saw on television that I'm reminded of. There was 1990, there was an expo, industrial exposition in Toronto, in Canada. And there was a carpenter who built a huge shed out of wood and this thing, inside which many of these exhibits were kept. This guy was had passed 8th standard or something, and he'd become a carpenter, and he was now a world famous carpenter, and he was interviewed on television. I happened to be in the US when this interview took place. And this lady asked this guy, she said, how did you support this trust? How did you come up with this idea? What did you do here and so on? After 3 minutes, he got very red in the face. He looked at the lady and said, you don't expect me to understand everything I know. I think there's some truth to that. That sometimes you know it, but you haven't understood it, but you can't teach it logically. So it doesn't become part of coursework either. But I think the important thing is that in order for the right brain to think freely, you should have an atmosphere of trust. You shouldn't say, this fellow is doing it in order to tease me or in order to... That really ruins it. So the right brain can thrive only in an atmosphere of trust. And that requires academic freedom, transparency in governance, and ethical behavior in the university. The minute the behavior isn't ethical, students become skeptical and they become cynical, and their right brain stops functioning quite as well as it should. There's some points for reflection. I mean, Aristotle and the need for logical verification. I was always amused by this story. This actually happens in an anecdote. Aristotle, if you know, had 2 wives. And he made a statement that women have fewer teeth than men. This was 260 AD or something like that. And then it was 1400 AD before somebody actually counted the teeth. Actually, many people had counted the teeth and found that Aristotle was probably wrong, but they were afraid to say it. Then finally, one fellow in 1400 AD said, I have counted teeth of several women, and turns out women have as many teeth as men. So you have to find some other way for being superior. This is not good enough. The point is that this is characteristic of both the Greek and the Hindu civilization, the traditions, where we used our left brain to collect data, and when we were confused, we went to a sage for explanation. We said, all these data is confusing me, you please tell me, explain this to me. And the sage used his right brain. So it's possible to use your left brain and somebody else's right brain, which is why collaboration sometimes work very well. And so you go to the sage, but the trouble about the sage telling you a generalization is that you're then afraid to contradict it, because after all, a sage said it, so you can't very well say he's wrong. So I think there has been a thing, but I think it was Galileo primarily who broke this trend. He said, no matter who says what, you have to do an experiment to verify it. In fact, Galileo insisted that scientific theories should come with a proposed experiment that may lead to its downfall. So, in fact, Einstein proposed that measurement of deflection of light during a solar eclipse. And he proposed that experiment. Eddington did the experiment. And that experiment could have decided the fate of general theory either way. I mean, it turned out the general theory was right. And Einstein's experiment worked very well to his favor. Einstein made this point also, that intuition is God's gift and logic is man's servant. He said, yet we ignore the gift and glorify the servant. I think this is inevitable, because all universities, you can only teach things logically. If you can't explain logically, there's no point in you can stand there hand waving, and the student will just go away with the thought that you don't understand it. So, I mean, there's no escape. All education is formally logical. But you have to somehow learn to nurture intuition, even if you can't teach it. I don't really know how it's done. But I think if you have it in the back of your mind, then it's unlikely that you will snub a student who says something suddenly out of the blue that appears silly. Okay, that's the first part. Then thank you. So then I come to part two. So we talked about research and teaching. I want to talk about demands that are made of the university. I want to start by telling you that most politicians and a lot of industry people sometimes come and ask you, how much do you teach? And we say about two classes a year, one course a year, one course a semester, sometimes occasionally two. And then so you have a lot of time left. So they have the feeling that we are wasting time. They don't understand that research, first of all, consumes a lot of time, and if you teach more than three courses a year, it's unlikely that you will have time for research. This is something that they don't understand. So they think you have a lot of free time, so they ask, what can we ask them to do? And this is very typical of people. They don't exactly say that, but they often tell you, why don't you do this, why don't you do that? And then I have a couple of other things in mind, and I tell them, why don't I do this also, this also? Then they say, you're being sarcastic. You said, I bet I'm being sarcastic. I'm busy. You don't try to tell me what I have to do. I have to decide. Our Senate has to decide what I have to do. I think that's an important point, that we should preserve our autonomy. But there are some demands that you should listen to. For example, in 90, I think this was back in 99, when Professor Natarajan was director, he sent me on some AACT assignments. He had a lot of contacts with AACT. And I found that we must have all gone there. Sometime we all go on inspections for colleges. I went to three colleges on the same day, 10 to 12, then 12 to 2, and then 2 to 4. And I found three teachers in chemical engineering were the same in all three, all were our PhD students. They had all been hired for 2 hours each in order to show numbers. Then I called, at that time I spoke to President Natarajan, then spoke to AACT chairman, and said, this is absurd. You can't have rules that cannot be followed. I mean, if you don't have teachers, what will people do? They'll do this. And then we talked about not having teachers for many courses. Then at that time, we felt that it's important that we have a virtual learning, because ICT information communication technology had really become very popular, and it's possible to teach these courses. So we thought of we had a workshop, and that's how that came. So we agreed that increasing the GER is an important part of the university's responsibility. The second was the research park. So I'll talk about the research park first and then go to it. This is the journey of the research park. I'll say a few words about the research university and the global economy. Then I'll say a few words about managing creativity. Then something about university research parks, their critical success factors, the IIT Madras research park, and the credit system. I'll talk about that and some recommendations for India. First of all, innovation and entrepreneurship are central to participation in the global economy, because IPRs constitute 40% of the income. For me it was a revelation. I didn't realize 40% of the income in the US and UK and Germany, these places, was from IPR. Research universities are the main source of creativity. Clearly you need young people, young minds, for you to have creative thoughts, but you need them in an atmosphere where there is no pressure of other kinds. And the universities have to manage their creativity better, which is what in the West they do very well. In fact, they learnt it from the industry. It was between the wars that the US industry in particular showed how you can tap into this. And the competitive success depends on localized concentrations of skilled people and technology. And Silicon Valley is the biggest example of that. There are two kinds of creativity. The university deals, education deals with knowledge, know-how and character. Of this, knowledge component progresses through what we call discovery and invention, the new things that come in. And discovery and invention require, in order to handle it in the university, you require what is called the magic garden approach. The magic garden approach says, you hire the best minds, really brilliant minds, provide them with a wonderful atmosphere. And if you're the director of the institution, you pray, because sometimes these characters will retire without doing anything. But on the other hand, their minds are so powerful, they're so good, that you can't afford not to have them in university. I mean, if things click, you could get really great dividends for the university, and you have to take a chance. And so that's called the magic garden approach. The second is innovation and the idea factory approach. The idea factory approach, more or less, I would say the biggest inventors of that were the Bell Labs, where they got people together, they got unlike minds together, And then they created the right atmosphere. They gave them a lot of freedom, but structured interactions. They insisted that these groups should meet, although they were from different fields, and talk about what they are doing. And they also had an IPR specialist among them. This IPR specialist would listen to conversations and suddenly find out that, I mean, he will spot immediately an idea that can be marketable. And then he will work with this group, get a patent. And this worked very, in fact, I was told, this is not first hand, but I've spoken to some people who were in Bell Labs in those days. They said in Bell Labs they had now what is called a solid state division. In those days they simply had a mixture of mathematicians, physicists, chemists, chemical engineers, electrical engineers, electronics, so on. And this group was very, very inventive. That's the group that produced the maximum number of results. After they put the labels solid state physics, you needed a visa. You had to have solid state physics somewhere in your background to be admitted. They haven't been quite as productive as they were before. So the idea is to bring minds together and pose a problem. They're intelligent minds, and if you have a mix of minds, chances are you will solve the problem cleverly. So you need that, the idea factory approach. And the question is, how do you manage creativity in the university? You can have minds that are unlike in different ways. One is cultural background. This is something that's very important. The US graduate school success is primarily because of this. Look, science is universal, but the scientists have a background. And depending on your cultural background, you have your prejudices. All of us have prejudices. And if you have a mix of cultural backgrounds, at least some of these prejudices can be overcome quite easily. And this has been true in the US graduate school. And success of the US graduate school, and it's easily the most successful education system, although now there are attempts to really destroy it, almost. But anyway, the disciplinary background, they can be different for different people. This is also very important. This is the Bell Labs example. And then the third is attitude. The university research parks, they're not new. They're about 30, 40 years, in fact, 50 years old now, 50, 60 years old. And the idea of the university research park was to bring people of different attitudes together. This is the so-called golden triad. In this case, it was made for IITM specifically. It's about students, faculty, and R&D personnel from the industry. These three people have to meet. They have to meet in an atmosphere that's fairly informal. And the R&D personnel have to be brought to the university. So they have to be brought at least close to the university, because faculty have their teaching load, they have the responsibilities in the university, and they can only interact with the industry if the industry comes to them. So the idea is to create this property space, and you have let them work together in an informal, semi-informal atmosphere. Now, the University Research Park is basically a property-based venture near a university campus. It creates a local concentration of skill and technology. You get a collection of people from different walks of life. They all work together in the same space. It promotes innovation, competitiveness, and entrepreneurship. There's a nice book on this. One of the references I've given you is a summary of research parks. It gives you an idea of how widespread this is. I think even the UK has about 50 research parks. US, of course, has more than 150. And basically it helps to convert research ideas into innovative technologies. It houses R&D of companies. This next step is not common in all university research parks. Creating and nurturing startups is peculiar to places where you don't have venture capital ready. For example, in India, we need to do that. And it basically drives technology-led regional economic development. This is an amusing thing. When I first noticed that, as I told you, when I looked at Silicon Valley and found that a large number of innovations had Indian names, IIT names in it, I went to the MHRD and said, we want to start a research park. Meanwhile, there was a meeting of the Association of University Research Parks in Washington. And Dr. R. Chidambaram, then principal scientific advisor, he was our chairman. So he called me and said, Ananth, you're going there as India's representative. I said, what research park do we have? What do I go and say? He said, I don't know, we don't have any university research parks. You're the only one talking about it, so you go. We can't not be represented. So I go all the way. And the first speaker is a Chinese lady. And she goes up, second, I was stated second. So she goes up and says, China has a very modest program on research parks. You're only planning 100 university research parks, only 100 acres per research park, only $1.2 billion per research park of federal support. So I put up my hand and said, can I go last? I mean, in the face of this, how do I go and talk? He said, no, Weissner said nothing doing. He was the organizer. He said, you have to speak next. And then I went and said, one proposed research park, 12 acres of land. And, I mean, the whole thing was, the contrast was striking. I must tell you though, China erred on the other side. I mean, they have, apparently a lot of the research parks are empty. They don't have occupants and so on. We have only one that's fully occupied practically, and we are now coming up with another 5 or 6. But the thing is, we are far behind in time in this. When I first started, it was an uphill task. I'll tell you about it more. So the critical success factors, these have been well reported in this National Academy's report. One local major research university has to be involved. The reason is, when people come to you with problems in the industry, you really don't know who is going to solve the problem. In IIT Madras, for example, in the Industrial Consultancy Center, we have a dean for it, and he has a talent map of IIT. By this talent map, he means he collects keywords from faculty members who say what topics they are experts in, you know, what are the keywords that represent their expertise. And when an industrial problem comes to him, it matches the keywords and then sends out a notice to all the faculty who may be interested in it. And you will be surprised, some mechanical engineering problem, one chemist will say, I know the answer to that solution. So you can't tell where the solutions come from. So you do need a major research university which is reasonably knowledgeable about what its faculty know. Then availability of skilled workers, access to finance, good park infrastructure, and quality of life amenities. This quality of life amenities is important in some places, particularly if you're in a small city, then you'll have to provide good amenities for it. You need strong and committed park leadership. I mean, your park may not succeed immediately. In fact, I remember there's a North Carolina Triangular Park in which is a large area which consists of a large number of industries put together, working with the universities in North Carolina. And the president of that park was at that meeting that I was talking about. And he said, university research parks are a great economic proposition. He said, we started in 1959, we broke even in 1989. Took him 30 years to break even, apparently. I mean, took him, he was only the 10th thing, CEO of the research park. But the point is that sometimes ideas click, sometimes ideas don't click. Stanford, for example, clicked within 2-3 years. In fact, nobody went to Stanford till the 60s, practically, early 60s. And then by the early 70s, everybody wanted to go to Stanford. And the big difference was the research park that Fred Terman had created. He called it something else. Now it's called the Stanford Research Park. And Fred Terman was the first one to think of it then. They broke even in 2 years. MIT's technology park, pathway, that again broke even within a few years. Sometimes you're lucky, sometimes you're not. And similarly, attract entrepreneurs and skilled managers, but government support is a critical enabler. I'll say a few words about government support in other places in compared to this. Why the IIT Madras Research Park? So when I found that about 50% of innovations were, IITians were involved in 50% of the innovations, so I went and told MHRD, I quoted Louis Pasteur. He said, discovery is the result of chance meeting a prepared mind. And there's another part to that sentence. He actually said, in experimental work, experimental research. But I didn't tell MHRD that. It's like Aswatthamahatha Kuncharaha. So I lowered my voice when I said that. Then finally, Sri Banerjee was a secretary who was very enlightened. I went to him and said that significant fraction of IPRs in Silicon Valley have IIT names, and we have been preparing minds, and chance has been meeting them in Silicon Valley. So it's about time chance met them in our backyard. And our proposed park was then, I needed permission to set up a park. IITs and other education institutions in India can't hold shares in companies, the federally, centrally supported institution. And the only thing that startups and small companies have are shares. So if they give you shares now, then they have a lot of value later. Stanford, for example, gets a lot from Google. And things like this, you hope that you will get a Google in your backyard and then you will get any amount of money for research. So we needed permission from MHRD to set up a separate Section 8 company. Section 8 is a non-profit company. So we structured it so that the director of IIT Madras is automatically the chairman of the Research Park Board. And we had a certain composition of the board. And we registered a Section 8 company. That company can hold shares in startups. Then we wanted land next to IIT. And that is hard to get. So happened, then in Chennai, there was an MGR film city, which was about 40 acres right adjacent to IIT Madras. And they were closing down because nowadays everybody does it by computer animation. They don't need these huge props and all. So immediately we applied for land. Out of 40 acres, we asked for 12 acres. And I remember the chief secretary was one Mr. Narayanan, very enlightened person, IAS officer. So I went to him and said, I want 12 acres of land. It was across the road from IIT campus. He said, Ananth, you have 630 acres and you want 12 acres from me. You know what the price of land is there. He said, I know, that's why I come to you asking. I can't pay for it, but I want 12 acres. He said, why? I told him, 630 acres is pure academic land. I'll only worship Saraswati there. Across the road, you give me land with you and with the industry, I'll worship Lakshmi. And he was an enlightened chief secretary. I mean, I didn't have to say anything more. He wrote immediately on the file, please put up the file for giving land to IIT. I mean, 12 acres, and we got land from them because of that. So, I mean, in a sense, a lot of things happen by chance. I mean, you sort of plan things, but you need his blessings. He puts the right chief secretary there, and then, so they gave us land. So they also were supposed to give us a lot of infrastructure. They produced road and all that, road, electricity, water, all that you get. And, the cost estimate at that time was 300 crores. It's now over. The complete thing has been built. Bhaskar has completed, my successor has completed the whole thing. It cost us 450 crores. The very first estimate in 99 was 200 crores actually. So I think the prices go up very fast. The minute you talk of anything coming up, you have to do it very quickly. We, out of the 300 crores, we asked for one third as grant from MHRD. I didn't ask for land, money from MHRD at all. I wanted to borrow this from World Bank. And I was ready to go to US when Sudeep Banerjee spoke to me and said, I can't have a director of mine go and ask for 100 crores from World Bank. If you go, ask for 10,000 crores. Not 100 crores. I said, what? I want only 100 crores. Where do I go for it? He said, I'll give it to you. I mean, it was an enlightened secretary to say that. And then he laughed and said, when I say I'll give it to you, I said, I'll initiate the file, but it'll take 6 years or 7 years. Because the first time they're giving money, 100 crores to an institution. And it took that long. 2008 is when we got the final. Actually, that same thing the chief secretary also said. He said, I'm writing this in the file, but it'll take you 6 years to get the land in hand. And we got the land in 2008. We got the money in 2008. And we started the process in 2000. So we got a 75 crore loan also from Canara Bank, because we want. And the rest was through internal accruals. That is, we had industry ask for space. And I was amazed. We were slow in doing this. But once I talked about the research park in public, 2001. Within the next 2 weeks, I had calls from industrialists, big industries in South in Chennai, asking for space there, saying they'll pay 20 years rent ahead of time. So they paid 20 years rent ahead of time. Tata's paid us, Murugappa Group paid us, and so on. So we got considerable amount through, that's what we call internal accruals. Alumni donations are about 20 crores. And more than that, alumni have been very involved. Been people giving advice to startups, and working with us. So we planned on 1.2 million square feet, and we worked that out. We didn't have really excellent logic in working out that number. And that's how I went and asked the government for 12 acres. Because I figured we had about 500 faculty members in IIT Madras. I wanted them to interact with industrial R&D people. And we figured 1 in 10 will click. I mean, if you have, so if you have 5,000 industry workers, then there's a good chance of some of them having a match between their interests and the expertise in IIT. So we wanted 5,000 R&D workers there. And Mr. Murugappan told me that in industry they need 250 square feet per industrial R&D worker. So 250 into 5,000 is what gave me this figure of 1.2 million, 1.25 million. And then you have FST calculations. On the basis of that, I wanted 12 acres, and that's how I got it. But we built 4,000 square feet in the first phase. What we did was we set apart 15% for incubatees. That is not set aside in the US. In the US, it depends. For example, the Stanford Research Park has, I think, 1,500 acres of huge space. And they even allow the industry itself to come there. We have said only R&D of companies can be in our research park. So we provided for some venture capital and for some legal advice. So we introduced what's called the credit system. This is Ashok Jhunjhunwala's idea. The IIT Delhi, for example, had about 30 years ago, they invited IBM to occupy space on campus. And they came in, but after the coming in, they locked their doors. They never interacted with the electrical and electronics department. Professor Raju was very disappointed because he wanted an active interaction. Finally, they got rid of IBM out of that because they were using it as real estate. This is a very real possibility. So we introduced what we call credits. We spoke to the CEOs. We called them all for a meeting. And we said, look, our benefit, biggest benefit is if you interact with us, then we get ideas for applied research. And so we said, every time you interact with us, we'll give you some credits. If you occupy 1,000 square feet of space in the research park, unless you earn so many credits, in the first semester we'll give you a warning. In the second semester we'll throw you out, which is what we do good. You know, we do a good job as professors with students. In fact, one of our alumni, he now has taken a huge space. He said, sir, I never failed in IIT Madras. Now you want me to fail in the research park because I can't earn this many credits. I said, you have to think about it, and it's worked out very well. We are somewhat flexible, but if they give R&D, give projects to IIT, they get some credits. They get for consultancy, for royalty, and so on. So all this can add up. You have to keep track of it, and they also come up with new ways of interacting with. So once you get all this in place, then you can calculate the credits and say, you want them. You have made only so many credits, you have to do more. So then this is the research park, is the entrance from the city entrance. We have a city entrance and an IIT entrance, the back entrance. And this is the first tower. And this is the atrium. And this is just at the entrance. You have these three strands. They are supposed to represent students, the R&D personnel, and the professors. The professors are knowledgeable in the area. But I keep telling my PhD students, you have a lot of ideas before you do your PhD, write them all down. Because once you become a specialist in a field, if you make a mistake, they'll say, this fellow is supposed to be a specialist, he made such a stupid mistake. And then you get constrained. So it's good to not to be constrained. So we have this ginger hotels. For example, you need people to stay overnight in the research park. So we used the good offices of Mr. Muthuraman. He's an old alumnus of ours. He was then chairman of Tata Steel. So I called him and said, I want Ginger Hotels to come here. Ginger was very reluctant. But once Muthuraman spoke to them, they came and set up, and they're very happy now. They've got 80% occupancy at all times. They are in the research park, they're in the 8th floor, and it's occupied all the time. This is the food court. Actually, I should have a picture with students in it. One of the attractions of the research park is that it has a wonderful food court, and the students go there, and when they go there they meet industry people, and then they get, now there are 200 student interns in the research park. And, I keep telling our people that good canteens are important in all educational campuses, because while we pretend to think with our heads, we actually think with our stomachs. I think if you give good food to people, then they open up and talk very nicely. In fact, the funny thing is, when you meet industry people in the research park and in IIT Madras, there's a big difference. In IIT Madras, the industry people who come become very defensive. Their problem is difficult enough. They complicate it further because they don't want you to think they're posing trivial problems. Whereas in the research park, they are absolutely frank. I don't know what the difference is. I think somewhere, if they come here, they get daunted by professors. And they don't get daunted by professors when they meet them in the research park. So this is some of our R&D clients. We have quite a distribution of clients. And one of the biggest clients today is the Saint-Gobain glass thing. They have a very big, they've taken 1.2 lakh square feet. And Santanam, their managing director, is an old student of ours. He tells me that the largest fraction of ideas have come from this research park. They have set up everywhere. But so some incubatees, nurturing innovation entrepreneurship. This RTBI, Rural Inclusive Technology, is primarily an initiative that's run by Professor Ashok Jhunjhunwala himself. It's DST supported. And, similarly, Rope is also another one. Gyan Data is a chemical engineering company. Actually, they do data analysis. And in fact, it's very disturbing. Gyan Data is run by two of my old students who are also professors in IIT Madras. And one of them, Professor Shankar Narasimhan, he tells me they don't need Newton anymore because he has seen a billion apples. Now he can interpolate and tell you where the next apple will go. He doesn't need Newton's laws at all. Actually, that's true of data analysis. Most of it, neural networks and all that, artificial intelligence, they don't seem to need this causal relationship. They have enough data and they can process it so fast they give you results. And Gyan Data has wonderful results working with the industry. Dwani research is, actually it should be called ultra Dwani research, it's ultrasound. This is one colleague in Krishnan Balasubramaniam in mechanical engineering. He is able to predict when, you know, big oil pipelines, where they will fracture, where they will break next. So if you can predict it ahead of time, people can repair it, and this makes a huge difference to oil companies. Then similarly, all these in Healthcare Technology Innovation Center is a very peculiar center. When I started the research park, Mr. Bahn was the, and Dr. Bahn was the secretary in DBT. And he wanted to support translational research in medicine. And he refused to support it in the education institution, saying it never gets translated. And because I had started the research park, he said, I'll give you, he gave us something like over 10 crores to set up this. And Mohan Shankar, who runs this from electrical engineering, young chap, they've done remarkable job in technology innovation in terms of products for health diagnosis and so on. In fact, he has more money than he can handle. He's actually telling them, don't give me money now, let me develop the present one and then I'll take money from you. So these have worked out very well, and this is a distribution, typical distribution, not the latest, but what you can see is primarily that it's not, engineering and design is about 33%, but you can see financial services 12%, and they're an important component. And people get used to you, you are a neighbor, then they are more ready to lend you money. They have more faith in your abilities and so on. Then social enterprise is another 2.2% up there. All kinds of auto is 8.3%, but that you must remember the research park started when the auto industry was floundering. 2008 was a low, but I think now we're getting more. Nissan has a big setup there. Xerox has the first setup in IIT Madras Research Park, first setup outside the US. And then Caterpillar started their very first center in IIT Madras. So the healthy beginning, but full occupancy, about 35 companies and 2,000 people. This was in 2011 when I left. And now there are over 100 companies and 5,000 people there. And the luster of clusters attracting other companies. One group of companies benefits from another group of companies. They are very positive. And about 200 student interns in the park. That's been a very big thing. Over 40 patents in the first year. Now we have 100 per year. You know, I have an amusing anecdote. 2006, I got a call from the Commerce Secretary and said, he said, Ananth, come to Delhi. You are getting a prize for the largest number of patents by an academic institution. I said, there must be something wrong. We have only 5. He says, others have less. It's not that we didn't have ideas, but we had no process for patenting. Everything was slow and we didn't know how to do it. After that, we became aggressive. We have, all of us now, every IIT has a patent lawyer and they give very good advice. These patent lawyers are amazing. When I first met this guy, he knew no technology. we were trying to patent something that a biomedical guy had done. Within 15 minutes, he asked the kind of questions that we'd never have thought of. He said, how is it novel, how is it this thing and so on. And we were able to patent that, but I was very impressed with their ability to go about identifying what is patentable and so on. And nowadays, actually, we still take more patents in the US than in India, because Indian patents take a long time. But there's enormous energy and enthusiasm in the entrepreneurial space. That is true nowadays of all students. And we have, I forgot to tell you, they've got a company called C6. They've left the research park and gone to Bangalore because they have better facilities for biological research there. But the second year students, three of them came to me when I was director and gave me their card. I said, what's this card for a second year student? Sir, please turn the card. If I turn it around, it says non-executive director, C6 Limited. They had started a company. And they were in the second year. By the time they finished, they became directors in the company. So this idea of young fellows thinking they can conquer the world is not uncommon, but now they actually think they can conquer the world in India. So this is the second phase. Bhaskar has finished this. This is actually an artist drawing, but it's been completed. So it's been, of course, they've learned from the first phase and done a better job. I have to say there are some lessons learnt. Extremely arduous process, 9 years to overcome bureaucratic hurdles. But I must say that I was amazed at how supportive the senior bureaucracy was. But we don't seem to realize it. We sit here and think the bureaucrats are getting in the way. But every time I got a hurdle, I thought about it. If I was in his place, I would have done the same thing. Because finally, the MHRD, for example, has to tell the parliament why they gave us 100 crores. And suppose the 100 crores had gone down the drain, if it had not worked out, how will he explain to them that he gave us this? So there are difficulties, and I must tell you some genuine hurdles. First was MHRD itself. Sudeep Banerjee unfortunately passed away, and the secretary after that was, and they were all supportive, but they were worried about what would happen. So we had an EFC meeting, and the planning commission objected to starting this and money being given. I had called Montek Singh Aluwalia twice to IIT to give extramural talks. He's a good speaker, and our students are really bright. They asked wonderful questions. He was very impressed. But my obsession right through my term was about the research park. So when he came, I spoke about the research park. 2 years later, when he came, I spoke again about the research park. And he said, you told me this already. I said, in any case, I am obsessed with it, so please listen. And then this objection from planning commission came. So I called him and said, you remember I spoke about the research park? He said, twice. I said, yes, twice. But you said it was a good idea. He said, I still think it's a good idea. Then I said, but your people are objecting to it. See, Ananth, all files don't come up to me. I said, now it has. And you'll be surprised. Next day, I got a call from the planning commission, the very people who objected. They said, sir, we are all for the research park. We are fully supportive. So we got that passed through the EFC. Then it went and got stuck in finance. And the finance is a very amusing meeting, because the secretary was really nice. She was a really receptive lady, but the file was there, and we had a CEO called Sandhya Shekhar. She was very good. She traced all these files, and she sent me an SOS saying, you better go directly to Delhi to see the secretary, because they are planning to reject our file. So I asked this lady, what happened to my file, IIT Madras file? She gave me an appointment, and the young lady, a director from the ministry, comes out and says, ma'am, we are rejecting it because we've not done it before. I said, a wonderful way to progress. She said, don't get so sarcastic. I said, look, I've spent 9 years and you can't reject it now. You have to listen to me. Then she listened to me for half an hour, and she tore that page and actually dictated in my presence a supportive statement. So, I mean, it's not as if they're just harassed. They have piles of files to deal with. And you have to follow it up and explain to them. She said, if you've done so much homework, I'll say yes. But that's why I'm saying it's not. I can get some credit for starting the process and persisting with it, but really, he decides, before Allah decides everything. The right persons appear at the right places. And so top officials once on board were very helpful. Once on board is an important point, because you have to go and explain to them. In fact, the finance secretary was so good, this was actually revenue secretary. She was so good, she asked me to explain the cash flow for the research park. We drew up a cash flow showing that we'll break even in 3 years. You might say, why 3 years? Because somebody said, even the clerk in finance won't put up the file unless it breaks even in 3 years. So we broke even in 3 years. So she said, there's the spreadsheet, please explain the cash flow. I said, I won't. I mean, by the time it goes. She said, what do you mean? You're asking for 100 crores and you won't explain. I said, the cash flow is a joke. She said, what do you mean? I said, every number there is entered, but there are four parameters there. I can juggle them and get you to break even on any year. You say 7th year, 8th year, and I had done all this. So she said, skeptically, show me. Let me see if you can break even in 7 years. Then I just changed two numbers, it came to 7. Because I had done all this homework. Then she said, she was really amused. She said, you know, you're the first person who's asking me for 100 crores and won't explain a proper cash flow. I said, look, this is research. It may click, it may not click. If it clicks, I'll break even very quickly. If it doesn't click, it'll take a long time, but it requires persistence. But she was very appreciative. She said, fine, I will support it. I'll take a chance. So I think we need to go and explain to people. Very often we academics think we understand it, they don't understand it, and so on. They don't understand it simply because they haven't spent time. They are as intelligent as you, sometimes cleverer. And you need to explain to them. And they did it in this case. So, but poor funding support from MHRD is still, funding support is still something that I have to complain about, because finally what we didn't, we never inaugurated the research park, by the way. We first had Mr. Karunanidhi, who was the chief minister. By that time, the chief minister changed, and chief minister and the HRM, Mr. Kapil Sibal, they were both going to inaugurate it. But 10 days, we even printed the cards, 10 days before the inauguration, Mr. Raja was arrested for the 2G scam. And then the relations between Congress and DMK became absolutely tense. And I was sitting in between, you know, I was nobody, but I had to talk to these two people. And then finally I told Mr. Kapil Sibal, look, I have built this research park with great difficulty, with support from all of you, but I cannot help all these developments, you should come in. He said, finally he refused, because Mr. Karunanidhi wanted to send a junior minister, and Mr. Kapil Sibal said he's too junior for me to join. So he didn't come. Then initially the Prime Minister himself was supposed to come, but he cancelled it for some reasons. Then this cancellation occurred. And then third time, it was Jayalalitha had taken over as Chief Minister. I invited her and Mr. Kapil Sibal. We almost fixed up, and again some political development and the tension developed, and the CM said she won't come. And then Kapil Sibal also said he won't come. Then finally, Mr. Kapil Sibal came for a science congress, and I invited him. I said, spare half an hour, come and see what we have done. He finally came, he spent 2.5 hours. He went around the research park, met everybody. We gave him lunch, and he was really impressed. And then he said, come to Delhi, you have to come in 2 weeks, come and explain what the research park is to my secretaries. I'm dealing with 3 ministries. I'll have 9 secretaries present. And then that evening I get a call from that night, and his PA says, sir, there's a small change in program. He wants you to come tomorrow. So I went the next day, addressed these 9 people, and on the spot, he was really impressed with the research park. He said, Mr. Ramaswamy was the DST secretary, good friend of mine. He made him the chairman of a committee to write a report on research parks. We suggested India needs 100 research parks, and at least you should start with the IITs. All the IITs should have research parks, and you should give 40% of the expense as grant. We got 100 crores, and that was not even a grant, it was a loan. They converted it to a grant afterwards. But the thing is, every opportunity you have to talk about what you're doing to bureaucrats, you should have the patience to explain fully. If they understand it, you do get support. I think that was an important part of it. And the point we made to them also, the power and value of ideas and IP generated are better measure of success of the research park than financial performance. And, so what India needs, 50 research parks, we said 100 actually. So we needed 40% of the cost, and a policy environment that's supportive, patient, adaptable, and focused on commercialization. We have no experience with research parks. When you have a first experience, you must be able to make a decision on the spot and get support from the government. I mean, at least your motives shouldn't be suspect. From the state, we got 10 acres. We were lucky. Other IITs, I think Kanpur has enough land, Kharagpur has enough land, but Bombay will not be able to get it right. And they've got land inside. if they've got a land which they've now got leased, so they're getting land also inside, but it's within the campus, and Delhi has no chance. Delhi is getting land very far away. So, but this is important. And from the university industries, I think the most important aspect is open-mindedness, open-minded collaborative research with an entrepreneurial mindset. What we told people, the first discussion that occurs is IPR. How do we share IPR with the industry? And I took the stand, I think Bhaskar has also taken the stand, that we will not discuss IPR till you actually have an intellectual property in your hands. Because if you anticipate what's coming, then there's no end to the limit. I mean, they go on saying, you give us most of it, give us. But when it actually happens, both parties are so happy that they are very honest. We have not had a conflict at all. We say 50-50, this is your idea, we did this and so on. And we are able to share this, and the rule is that the IPR belongs to both the industry and us. But we have the first right of, the industry has the first right of refusal. If they don't want to use it, then we can give it to somebody else. Otherwise, it belongs to both of us. I think that's the last, I won't show you the video. So can we break here at this stage and then go on to the next? Then,
if there are a few questions,
questions. I'd be happy to try and answer them. Yeah, please.
I think we have been hearing a lot about GER.
About?
GER.
Yeah.
This from for the tertiary education.
Yes, it's everywhere. But we are talking about GER in higher education. Yeah. I know these are questions that always arise. In my opinion, not enough. But on the other hand, what's within my purview, I can push. And then the others will push. I mean, development always occurs in spurts. In fact, when the research park came up first, very first thing that the secretary asked me, it was before Sudeep Banerjee, secretary said, how can I give you 100 crores? Then I have to give all the others 100 crores. I said, look, this is the difference between a three-legged race and individual race. If I run at 10 seconds in 100 meters. If you tie me up with one more IIT, we'll both run at 3 seconds. I mean, at 30 seconds for 100 meters. I said, when they have an idea, give them the money. When I have the idea, give me the money. So I think you can't stop. You know, if GER in higher education progresses faster than in the other sectors, you have to still allow it to go. Because somebody with initiative has come up, allow them to go, then the other one will pick up automatically. I think in all sectors we are behind, but fundamentally, if you talk about these, health and food is far more important. That's one of the biggest problems in India. But I think you can see so much and know more.
Why you wanted to be outside the campus of the?
Exactly what I said, sir. The industry tends to be very competitive. I'm not blaming the industry. This is a description. It is difficult, it's not impossible. For example, IIT Delhi, right next door is JNU. There are at least 150 acres of land there. But because of political reasons, they can't get it. But if that land can be allotted, then something. See, you talk about a prof consulting. If it's right across, he'll go across. The other thing is, secondly, we get ideas. The minute you get the idea, you must be able to discuss with your collaborator. Otherwise, it's sort of exponentially, your enthusiasm dies down. You forget to discuss it. Things like that happen. So I think it has made a big difference, huge difference. Say that again?
In GIDC only. We have a biotechnology park. It is in GIDC only.
I see.
Very close to the industry and far away from the education. Experts are going there.
Yeah, it does make, it makes it difficult.
Yeah.
That is, after all, my prof has to teach. He teaches a class, goes there, comes back. If he has to go across the city, then he can't come back for class. Yeah, and students' involvement, that's very important. It's amazing how many BTech projects are coming back. We have a center for innovation in IIT Madras. We started that with an 81 batch of alumni. One of the workshop areas we emptied and gave it to the students, and they run the show. It's called Center for Innovation. The principle is walk in with an idea, walk out with a product. And it's actually worked. Three of those ideas have clicked. One of them is this Aether electric scooters. who moved to the research park, then they moved to Bangalore, because now they've become, but they've got several hundred crores of funding. So they are situated in Bangalore now. But the point is this, that these students, and these same students in C5, I keep asking them, how come you smile so much here and never in class? You know, after all, I'm spending so many hours trying to teach you something. At least one or two lectures you can smile. The fellows, they're really smiling all the time. They work 24/7. But when it comes to, I think you need this enthusiasm to pick up. And they, the students can get sponsorship of all kinds from the industry if they are right next door.
Was there any resistance from the stakeholders when you wanted to go for research park? Research park?
Yeah.
When we had a university of Hyderabad in 2008, we wanted to start the knowledge innovation park. All the stakeholders have opposed it. Finally, we could not proceed.
No, from the state, we wanted, first thing is we. No, that, sir, there is always a murmur. We had a, I put out an announce in which everybody could say everything. And a lot of them said, this director is very foolish. He wants to go into other areas instead of education and things like that. But I don't respond. I keep quiet and watch. After 2 weeks, somebody will respond and they'll say, no, no, this director is not so foolish. And then they'll finally come to the conclusion, after all, the director is reasonably clever at that stage. But the idea is that it's not that people say it wantonly, but they do feel reservations about new projects. But if you allow them time and don't immediately accuse them of thing, then it all settles down. I am back in IIT Madras after 10 years. People told me after 3 years as director, nobody will smile at you. But after 10 years, I was away for 6 years and I am back and people are still smiling. So, not so bad. Sir, there are violent objections because all academic people have strong opinions. But you allow this, you know, to allow the discussions to go on and then it settles to your point. Even now, there is a fraction of the faculty who will not deal with the research park. I would expect only 10% of the faculty to actually interact with the research park. 10% is a good number.
So, what are the prospects
in
tier 2 cities?
Yeah.
The research parks in tier
2 cities. Sir, there we recommended something about tier 2 cities where land is cheaper, you should give enough land so that industry can also be located there. For example, we recommended this even for Kharagpur. Actually, I don't know what the final decision is, but our 100 crore, our, we said 40%, but the government decided they gave us 100 crores, so they'll give 100 crores to other IITs. So Kanpur, Kharagpur, Delhi and this thing have been given 100 crores each. So, but tier 2, I think you will have to attract them by giving space for the industry itself to be located. For example, HP was started in Stanford, on land that Stanford gave.
Has the actual break-even happened?
Actually?
Actual break-even, in two sense.
No, we have more or less broken even. In fact, we didn't take 75 crores from Canara Bank, we took only 40 crores. And at the moment, the director of IIT Madras is in a position, the chairman of the IIT Park is in a position to return the 50 crores or 40 crores. Canara Bank doesn't want it back. He says, you're a prestigious client, you stay. So, they'll use it. The idea is that you cannot make profit in the research park. Any profit that comes should go back to improving the amenities in the park, plus or go for research in IIT. That's the only thing that's allowed. And in fact, Section 8 company, we had a lot of problems. MHRD said, you do it as a society. We have done other societies before, we have not done Section 8 company. But I consulted auditors and lawyers, a very, really eminent group. And they said, this is the best for you in the long run. Societies can be taken over. You need a lot more financial discipline here, but this is good in the long run. So I insisted on it. In fact, the secretary was quite unhappy with me. He said, you're being very, he said, stubborn. I said, that's one of the characteristics of a good leader. But he said, but he finally agreed, huh?
That Section 8 company is very much essential. The thing is, you need a freedom. And outside the statute, if you want to work, only Section 8 company.
Also, societies can be taken over. In fact, we have 3 secretaries from the state government on our board because the land cost there is about 600 crores. So the state said, if I have invested so much, I need representation. We were worried, but the 3 secretaries have been extraordinarily good, sir. They have given us excellent advice. It's simply a matter of you have to trust people to begin with, and you have to keep them fully informed.
So do you have any collaborative arrangements for establishing research corridors with the state-aided universities and research policies?
We don't, but I think we are open to it. I mean, I'm now talking practically for Bhaskar, but I think IIT Madras is open to this. We are willing to help in this regard, and it's possible. But land is the biggest problem in these cases.
50 crore is given to whoever is demanding to buy biotechnology.
Not interest free, sir, 9%. Yeah, yeah. No, not, they're not fools, they won't give you interest free loans. No, but the point is that it's still worth it if your returns are good enough. Right now it's working very well. I think the research park in IIT Madras is a rarity. It's only one of its kind. So people are discovering, actually they used to say profs are impractical and all that. Now they're discovering profs actually have good ideas. And it's simply a matter of finding the right prof for the right thing. Sir, our interest is primarily, no sir, there are two things I'll tell you. The real, your product is not the student. In fact, Charles West makes a warning. He says, don't claim the student is your product, because the minute you pat yourself on the back for a good student, there'll be a bad student who will spoil your name. So he says, your product is education. The question is, how will you improve education? There are two legs you need. One is the basics. That's where you stand on the shoulders of giants, the previous people and all, that part we take care of very well. But on the other hand, how are you connected to reality? And one is the interaction with industry. And if you have that interaction, it's reflected automatically in your lectures, in your coursework and things like that. In fact, I must tell you one amusing story. This is about, I'm 73 now, so this is 25 years ago, I was teaching mass transfers, very senior faculty, first time teaching, And our students, I was teaching design of cooling towers. I'm supposed to be a theoretical guy. So the students have a way of smiling at you, saying, you talk, but you really don't know, you only talk theory. All this will be communicated through a smile. So I decided that it was time to call a student of mine who actually runs a cooling factory. He makes cooling towers for a living, Shriram Towers. So I called Shivaram and said, Shivaram, Monday morning, 9 o'clock, you're taking the class and talking to them about cooling tower design. And he said, sir, I have a meeting. I said, this is Guru Dakshina. My time is fixed. And he came, sir. He actually changed his meeting time. I was sitting in the back. The students didn't know. He gave a lecture. After half an hour, front two fellows in front of me. One fellow tells the other fellow, not bad, Ananth knows design. So I had to have my fun. So I tapped him and said, yes, I do. And the guy became very white and said, sir, we didn't know you were here. But actually, they have a right to be skeptical. I mean, skepticism is part of any intellectual thing. And I think this interaction helps a lot. Now, for example, from the research park, we have many people coming and giving top-up lectures. One lecture in 40, two lectures in 40, and that sort of connects what they do to what you teach in class. And we are not that much at odds with practice. I mean, theory is quite closely. In fact, in cooling tower design, the design I taught was slightly better than the one they were using. But in the sense, I mean, I had juggled the mathematics a bit. And Shivaram said, sir, industry is so conservative, they will always design this way. If they don't iterate and come to the design, they won't be comfortable.
I just want to ask, do you have any provision for the traditional technology there in the research park?
Sir, it's
promote the traditional, that is dying.
It depends. RTBI does support
the
work.
Have your research park?
Yeah, there is a fraction in the India incubation part, 3% part. There are small companies that support traditional technologies. And we also do another thing. In IIT Madras, we do something called socially relevant projects, where we decided we support all these, what is traditional and other things, not necessarily with high tech, what is relevant. And some of them have succeeded extraordinarily. Making dyes, vegetable dyes, for example. Most of the money goes in transporting the liquid.
liquid particle. So how do you drive the processes and we combine the displays of use? That's been done for the Gandhi graph. Those people wanted we did that for them. So I think we get contacts with these people because of the socially relevant part. Then we tell them that we're not necessarily hated. We discuss with you, we can be solved. But a large number of social problems are not easy to solve. They are still there only because they have to solve. So once or twice you get a solution which is very easy. People are very peaceful.
So let's have a short break.